Hey, Shelvies. Buckle up for a new episode of the Shelved Books Podcast, where every writer is a story that may never see the light of day. This is the podcast where authors share the stories that they shelved, the manuscripts that they may never publish. Then they explore the reason why they shelved this story. Welcome to the Shelved Books Podcast.
All right, welcome to the first episode of the Shelved Books Podcast. I am your host, Kate, and my co-host,
Angie Sandro.
Yes, and thank you so much for joining us. First, we would like to thank Kaz, DJ Kaz, aka CJ Edmonds, for our wonderful, short but sweet intro for our episodes. He so graciously gave us his time. And if you want to check out, he's a singer and a DJ at Mellow Touch. If you want to check out his stuff, I will put his links on the link tree. Our links, Angie and mine, are also on the link tree below. So just check that out if you'd like to mosey on in and check out our Amazon. You know, our books are on Amazon and wherever you want to buy books, they're there. But just plug for that.
You have to plug.
Yes. So happen, you know, if you ever want to mosey on, follow us. And all the links to the Shelf Books Podcast media, social media, will also be in our link tree. So if you want more Shelf Books content from us, then you can follow those links as well. We appreciate it. So thank you. So we're gonna, for this episode today, we're gonna talk about what is the Shelf Books Podcast and why we put it together and what we hope is going to be the growth of this podcast and the guests. Because our hope actually is to have writer guests on and to talk to them about shelved books. What does that mean? What does a shelved book mean for you, Angie?
It means that book that you've poured your heart and soul into. I'm trying not to be dramatic, but this is how I feel.
Yes.
Poured my heart and soul into it, and then I had to shelve it, never to see the light of day, and it tears my heart.
Just gathering dust in the square.
I mean, it's in the computer, you know, so it's not really dusty. It's just basically dead. It's a dead book. It's like, it's something that no one will ever read. That all those ideas and feelings and emotions and characters that you fall in love with, that you put into the story, they're just hanging out, maybe hoping to be something come out.
Gathering digital dust as
digital dust. Digital. Yes.
Okay. Whichever hard drive platform you as authors like to use and like to store. I, as an author, have countless folders and countless files of books that have been started and stopped, and some that are, I guess the thing about me is that if I complete a book, I get so attached to it that I have a hard time shelving it, even if it's like dead on arrival or really should not be published at all. Because I'm like, I need some return on investment here. Even if it's not like, I get it, we didn't get into writing for the money. Okay, we did not. And for those who have been blessed with bestsellers, oh my gosh. I mean, oh my gosh, we dare to dream that.
Yes. For our props.
Yes. So, but I mean, let's face it, a lot of us, I mean, I think all writers, name every big writer. I mean, I feel like even you know, Jim Patterson? Did I just make a mistake there?
James.
Patterson. Right, exactly. Yes. I mean, I believe even James Patterson has shelved books, regardless of how many books he comes out in a year. I feel like he has like 5 come out in a year. And I'm like, but I'm pretty sure he shelved 1 or 2. And it doesn't mean, you know, shelved books, a shelved book doesn't mean it is forever shelved. Mm. might one day be resurrected. Maybe you wrote it and it just wasn't the right time for it. Like, it wasn't, the publishing industry just wasn't looking for that kind of book. Like,
yes.
Remember when vampire fatigue was happening? Like, yeah, like when Twilight came out and everybody was writing vampire books, and then eventually everybody would, and that bubble popped, and you know, and then mm-hmm. it was like this time where nobody wanted vampire books, or if
there no was, one wanted like fantastical like elements, like for a while, it was mostly contemporary for a while. What was that, 10 years? I'm like dating myself, like 10 years ago now. So maybe more. But yeah, I mean, that's one of mine. Like, it was a story that had, you know, magical elements, and it was not, I couldn't sell it, you know? So.
What was it about that book? What were the magical elements that just wasn't attractive?
It was Hound of Anwen, which I'm horrible at titles. Okay, so I have the stupid titles, but it was Hound of Anwen, and it had a girl who saw ghosts. The Jude, he had supernatural telekinetic abilities, and there were some fairy-like creatures that were actually aliens from space. Hey, so totally explains why it was shelved, right? But yeah, it was one of my favorite stories.
I mean, I feel like if you tried selling that now, I think it would work, because it's like right now, like from what I'm seeing that's coming out, it's like, I think it will work. I thought it was I think I read a few chapters of that. I thought it was like Egyptian inspired.
No, that was one of my other shelf books, Kate. That was one of the other ones. That was my mummy he was a genie. My genie book.
Jinn book, right? Is that the
one? He was Jinn, and she Cairo, the main character, she, you know, they yeah, it was that was also shelved.
Okay. But going back to the first one so was it like, is it because wasn't it working because there were too many elements of the paranormal in the book?
Well, I tried the Rashomon effect where where it was there were two lead characters, they were twins, and one each chapter would rotate their point of views, but they kind of showed the same scene from the other character's point of view, so it just didn't work. And I queried, and I had an agent. She was like, "It's the Rashomon effect," and I was like, "What?" And so she's like, "Yeah, if you just fix that and then resubmit." And by then, I was already like, "You know what? I'm moving on. I'm going to do the story that I actually published, which was my Dark Paradise,
right? And that series, Dark Paradise series, which has
So at that time, I was like, I just didn't want. I don't know. I wasn't that I didn't want to go back and fix it. It was just I just mentally didn't know how to change something that I loved so much at the time. And then, you know, a couple of years later, I was able to, okay, I can really see it for what she was meaning, you know, what she meant regarding how it didn't work, and I could edit it then. But by then, it was just couldn't really sell the paranormal. I guess it was urban fantasy. So we tried, and it just didn't work out. So
do you think that, you know, is it the type of book that you would explore again, or are you willing to edit it again, or is it like really just, oh,
I have edited that book like 15, 20 times over the last 20 years. Like every so often I'm like, oh, I missed those characters, I'm going to read the book, and then I read and then I start editing. And so it's probably edited like multiple times since then. But I don't know. I think I was just so disappointed because it was one of my first books. It was actually the second book I ever wrote.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was really attached to it. I was really attached to it. And because it was actually the first one that I don't know. Anyway, yeah, it was a hard one to let go. And once I did let go, I think it's just been hard to go back to it because I don't want to feel those feelings of disappointment and that maybe this time it after all the work I put into it over the last, 10 years, that it still won't sell, so.
Right.
Let it go.
So did you ever consider rewriting, starting from scratch, chucking that and then because I heard from there was this, her name escapes me, but what she would do is, she's actually a best-selling author now. And with one of my dream agents, by the way, she switched from her agent to her, my dream agent. And so she's an international bestseller at this point. And I am blanking on her name. Author of Wings of Ebony. I forget, but her book is Wings of
Ebony. I don't have a Google. Siri? Alexa? Where are you?
Who's the author of Wings of Ebony? No.
And he was filmed in Los Angeles.
No, stop. Texas.
Wait, did she say the name? I
didn't hear. She might have, because she's spying on us.
Amazon, you. Wait, so yeah, so what, did she say the name? Did she happen to say the name?
I'm scared to ask again.
No, don't ask. But yeah, her, the author of Wings of Ebony, what she would do is she would write the entire story, just vomit it out, and then know that it's not working, delete everything, and start over. I'm I still need to get to that point where I can do that, because sometimes when, I said, when I finish the book, I'm like, I need to try and salvage whatever garbage I have, spewed out. Has that ever happened? Do you feel that way? It's if you if you finish the book, that you have to try everything in your power to try and, find it home somewhere?
So I think I'm brilliant. No, I'm just kidding.
Don't we all?
Right? I don't know. I think, by the time actually, so I'm one of those who, as I edit as I write. And I can't move to a new chapter until it's exactly what I want it to be.
Right.
And so by the time I get finished with the first draft, it's been edited multiple times. It goes through me and my critique partners and stuff. And then at the end, I go back and then we do a big edit, and then it goes to my critique partners again. So by the time I'm finished and ready for it to actually be submitted, it's been through multiple passes. And I hate it. I have no desire whatsoever to look at it anymore. I don't care. It's lucky that I don't kill off all the characters at the very last minute. You're dead. I don't want to see you anymore, because I'm just so tired of these characters. And so, one of the good things is I learned that you have to kind of put it aside and let it sit. So I'll usually let them sit for 2 months or 3 months or a year or two, just so I can fall in love with the characters again before I try and do a big massive edit. So when I think about the idea of trying to revisit those characters and write the entire story all over again, if it doesn't work that first, I'm not doing it. I gotta move on. I'll try something else.
and I think that's what some of the newbie writers don't expect. It's by the time it reaches to the point where you think it's you never submit a first draft ever. It's no matter how I don't even think Nora Roberts, I think Nora Roberts can get away with submitting a first draft, but only because writers like her are already veterans. I think they already know what they, which I'm so curious about, if one day we can ever convince her to get on this podcast. I'm dreaming big. It's if we can convince, I've always been curious and wanted to ask, does she write and then just submit to her publisher? is there no like editing anymore? Does she still have reading partners? Does she still show it to other writers first before submitting it to her publisher? Does she show it to her agent? Or because I'm pretty sure she's at that point where she can sell a book on just one sentence and not even have written the book yet, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm just curious about that. And if she's ever, I'm pretty sure she's shelved books also, because there are some books of her that I've read that I'm like, not the typical Nora Roberts I'm used to. And I feel like, and I'm sure us as readers who follow like authors who have prolific, like really long number of books, we know that there's like a certain book in a series or whatever that you're like, maybe should not have written that one. Maybe should not have published that one. It's like, you know that it's the shelved book that should have been the shelved book, but it's still
exactly for mine.
Well, let's just not out them as of yet, because if we want them to become a guest, you just don't want to start with the question of why did you publish that book? Why did it?
Right. or why did you not stop at book 15?
Yeah, it's
I mean, you read 25 now, but 15 is where the peak was. Maybe you should have why? That's a completely different topic, right?
And so it's like, for me, my shelf book is actually, it's like one of the first romances I attempted to write. I actually wrote this during when I was studying my MFA in creative writing, because when we were doing fiction, my fiction class, my fiction teacher, professor, gave us the leeway to either write a short story or like the first chapters of a book. And at the time, I wasn't the short story type. I'm like, why would I do that if I can just start a novel, which I was thinking would eventually become my thesis? Like, because when you are in the creative writing MFA, your thesis is essentially if you're a poet, you write like a collection of poetry. If you're a fiction writer, you write a novel or a short story collection, and then you write a paper based on the process of writing that, whatever it may be, and then you present that to your panelists. So that's what I was thinking. Like, I was forward thinking. I was like, I will start it here in fiction, and then we were going to have a round table critique circle, and which was such a, you know, my unmature brain, my immature brain, like, could not take it, because like you mentioned, I was brilliant. And yeah, whatever I wrote was gold, and I could not take criticism. But anyway, the story of that romance was the main character, the female main character, her husband just died of an aneurysm. And so we're already starting with a sad story. And then the husband left it in his will that she should stay with his twin brother, who looks exactly the same as him. And just imagine, like, I'm pretty sure as I'm telling you this, you can already see the problem. You can already see it. Okay, because it's
like, brilliant, Kate.
Right? It's amazing, bestseller quality. Okay, so
her airplane,
her husband, twin brother, the twin brother was named Vincent at the time, because one of the anime characters I loved was named Vincent. So I'm like, okay, let me name him after my favorite main character at the moment. And so he's Vincent, and he's a billionaire, and he's broody and handsome. And okay, so she has to stay with him, right? And so right then and there, I did not think about the the cons of having our female character fall in love with the twin brother of the husband that just died. Because I'm like,
I mean, I'm kind of intrigued. Like, yeah. I kind of want to read it. Like, I do.
It's a flashback. Because the thing is, there are flashbacks in the story because they all grew up together. Okay, they all grew up together. She was actually adopted by their family. I think she has a really... Look, this book is really sad, okay? Sad. Okay, she has a sad backstory somewhere. I think her parents died and she was adopted by the parents of the twins and they grew up together. And the thing is, Vincent has been in love with her from the very beginning. He has been in love. But he has like a... He has the bully personality where... I will bully you, but I love you. That kind of personality. It's like, I will be mean to you, but my meanness is coming from a place of love. That's his character. So her, as a young girl, could not understand where that affection is, like where that mean affection is coming from. It's like,
right.
Her, but then he would leave a kitten for her to find somewhere, you know, as a way to say sorry without saying sorry. But eventually, because he couldn't stand being with her, he left to, you know, stay at a boarding school or somewhere. And then, so she was left behind with the other twin brother, who's like the intellectual, kind-hearted guy. And they ended up growing up together, getting married eventually. So
were they in love?
Because the thing is, the twin brother sort of knew that Vincent really loved her because they're twins, so they understand each other. So he knew that Vincent really loved her and that's why he left. But she loved I think she was falling in love with, because there are scenes with them as teenagers as well, and then he would come home for like special occasions and whatnot. And so they would have interactions and, you know, and so she would have feelings for Vincent, but every time she would start to have feelings for him, he would do something that would be like, you know, without intentionally meaning to be mean is mean. And she ends up commiserating with the, you know, with the intellectual brother who understands, safe, who is comfortable. And so she ends up marrying him instead. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and then so he dies of an aneurysm. And and because he knows that Vincent really loves her, he puts it in his will that she has to stay with him, you know. Mm. So that's where, like, the story starts. And I'm like, now as the writer I am today and the person who understands plot. Putting emotions, having emotional characters, emotionally grounded characters, especially in a romance, it's like, how can you navigate a mourning widow of a woman who will eventually fall in, I mean, it's happened before, the mourning widow falls in love with the new guy, but the extenuating circumstances is he's the twin, so yeah. They look alike, and you know, it's so how can you differentiate, how can the readers differentiate between the two? So I feel like the only way it could work or would work, and here is my not giving up brain on something.
Because they could.
Yeah, if they are not twins. Like if maybe the intellectual brother is the older by maybe a year or two only. And
or distance in time.
Huh?
A distant, like if 3 or 4 years.
Yeah, something.
Not right away.
Something like that. But, and then she would be like exactly in the middle of their age. So she would be like just a couple of years younger than the oldest. And then she would be just maybe a year older than Vincent, you know, something like that.
Which is a good, you know, having the younger man, that's pretty cool too.
Yeah, it's that makes it a bit, you know, like the younger man falls in love with the woman. But again, it's still the brother aspect. So, so if you make it, it's biblical, isn't it? Right.
Like, Mary, I'm going to die, so I'm going to pass you to my brother.
Here. Yeah, like, go. maybe best friends, but then again, that there's still something. It's like, I'm trying to, I'm salvaging it. When wait.
We're just brainstorming these show books here. You know, if you have anyone that you need help with, just let us know.
Because you never know, like with every guest that we have on, there's a possibility that this shelf book actually becomes reality, you know?
Bestseller.
Yeah, again, it's like, what if we, and then we're the ones who discovered. So we need to be in the acknowledgement section, please.
Yes.
I mean, come on. We helped bring that book back to Are we getting ahead of ourselves here? Come on.
Of course. Like, because, you know, we've got to dream big, right?
Yes.
We shelved our books, but we got to dream big. Like, someday.
We are right.
Going to be bestsellers.
Congratulations. Why not dream big? That's the point right there. And I think that is a good place to end our first episode. Now, if you are a listener who is also a writer or a budding writer, aspiring writer, published writer, wherever you are in your writing journey, if you have a shelved book story that you would like to share with us here on the Shelved Books Podcast, you can send us an email at theshelvedbookspodcast@gmail.com. So shelvedbookspodcast@gmail.com. I'll also have that at the description below so that you can share your story with us, and then we might even read it on our podcast. Or if we like it enough, we might even invite you as a guest.
But you have to be funny.
Yes.
Okay, you don't have to be funny.
But we will, you know, if we like your story enough, we will invite you to be our guest on this podcast. Okay. And I think this was a good first episode, good first start podcast that I think has legs and will go really far. And that is just me being a writer, hoping and dreaming and
being brilliant.
Asking for any excuse to procrastinate from actually writing. That is what this podcast ultimately is.
It really is. Because right now I have just finished my latest story that I worked on since the pandemic, like 2 years. I don't know if I can say that word online.
Oh,
maybe we should cut that out. I don't know. I've been working on it for 2 years and I think it's effectively shelved right now.
I'm curious about that. And please.
It's my archaeology story. It's so funny because I was writing it during the dark times when I was stuck in my house by myself, the dark times. And so I needed something to make me laugh. And so in my opinion, because I'm brilliant, like, right? Mm-hmm. It's hilarious. Hilarious.
Yeah. We need that. We need to laugh. We need to see. Please let us not make this book a shelved book. This needs to see the light of day.
And maybe it will.
Yeah. Maybe it will. I am eternal optimist. I will. And I am not the type to let go. I'm not the type. You will see. As this podcast progresses, you will see that Angie and I are actually the opposites. She can let go. I cannot. I will try to see now that I've revealed my shelf book, I'm actually brainstorming the darn thing. And
I'll read it because, you know, I read everything that you write. Like,
so,
I own most of her books. I'm like, we're probably your biggest fan. So, you know,
writers out there, you know what? If you want a critique partner, it's Angie, because she will make you feel so good about your book that you're like, it's ready. It's ready.
Well, because you're brilliant. I keep saying that word, but it's true.
Brilliant. We cannot repeat this enough. And now it's going to live in infamy on the internet forever. I'm so afraid. But really, thank you for joining us on this first episode of the Shelved Books Podcast. I am your host, Kate, and my co-host,
Angie Sandro.
Join us again next week for a new episode, and we just might have a guest for all of you. So thank you, and keep on writing. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Bond writing. We need like an ending jingle or something.
I know we do, right? We will. We will eventually figure that out.
And that was another episode of the Shelved Books Podcast. We hope you enjoyed today's episode. Till the next one, stay safe, read more, write more, and continue to be at your creative best. The world is waiting, and so are we.